Hey folks, Kilt-Man here, Kilt-Man, at your service. That's better. Yeah, I say Kilt-Man, not Caveman. Oh, look at this shaggy mess. I am wearing a kilt. It is the Hunting MacLeod. A less than subtle clue. An awesome theme for Captain Jack Sparrow. Aye. Why? Because, well yes, those attentive of you will know I have this, the John Rackham Buccaneer hat. Some would go with Jack Sparrow hat, and they'd be wrong. It's not a John Rackham hat. A Buccaneer Paul Darkey type hat. So, feeling at my most buccaneering, my most high seas and spirited, and just to prove it, we have a bit of a cutlass, bit of an old one. But you all know me, you all know how much I love my whiskey, my fire water. Well, today is a new experience for Kilt-Man, because inspired by this, and is also inspired by the fact that I finished my bottle of Glenfiddich yesterday, and going back to the stockpile of drinky poos, which I got for my birthday, of which there's still about 45 bottles left. Someone didn't pay attention to the rules, and they didn't buy me whiskey. They bought me rum! Where's rum gone? Why is the rum gone? And this is a Sailor Jerry, the original Sailor Jerry, spiced, 80 proof. Ooh, shit. Made by a company called Tattoo, I think. Crafted in honor of Norman Sailor Jerry Collins, father of the old school tattoo. Ah, father of the old school tattoo, yeah. Helps to read the full label, Kilt-Man. Now, I'll be honest, I know next to nothing about rum. You have it rum and coke, well, I don't. And I've had Malibu, because when I was out in the Caribbean, because that's where Kilt-Man got married. Yes, and the sunny enclave of Jamaica, man. So there you go, back in 1992. Back in the days of free sailing ships, you know, cannons on board. Mobile phones hadn't been invented. Well, they had, but they were a bit huge. They'd sink a ship if you had a mobile phone on it. So, I want you guys to be privileged to join me. Well, if you've got rum, get it and join me. If not, get a tipple of your choice. Put your best buccaneering boots on and let's go on an adventure to fame and misfortune. Blame and misfortune. So, I have no idea what this will taste like. But being a seasoned whiskey drinker, can it be that hard? Arr, me hearties! Now, no preparation, no glass, no water, no ice. Neat. As King Neptune intended it. Yeah. Doesn't smell too dissimilar from whiskey, if I'm perfectly honest. It says spiced. I didn't get no hint of spice. Bottoms up, yup. Watch out for the peak of your tricorn hat. Quite nice. It's quite nice. But you never can tell from the first sip, can you? It's very smooth. I thought it'd make you wince. Whiskey. I drink whiskey. Even someone drinks whiskey all the time, you know, day by day by day, drinks whiskey. Sometimes the first one, you go, you always see cowboys doing, they go, you know, whiskey, bartender, give me whiskey, just give me the bottle, you know, and they shoot the top of it, and they take a swig and they, like that, so they've got prairie dust in their mouth as well, and it does happen, it happens to me sometimes it makes you wince, not necessarily a bad thing. It just means you're reacting to it. It's hit you. This, I really thought was going to make me go, ooh, boy. Scared of titties off a buffalo, you know. But it's actually quite all right. Maybe because I drink whiskey, it doesn't really matter. You watch, in about 5 minutes' time, I'm going to be upside down. Hanging from the lampshade. Making Tarzan calls. I can't see why Captain Jack Sparrow would be so enamoured with this stuff. Obviously, back in them days, it would be, I don't know, it'd be really rusty nails, wouldn't it? It'd be barnacled as hell. It'd be a savage taste. Only hard, seafaring folk could actually palate it. But it seems, in today's age, more refined age, us chaps of bygone eras can happily coexist with the modern version. That is very smooth. I'm only getting a vague, spicy sort of, you know, taste to it. I don't know how prevalent that was supposed to be, but, you know, it's there. I like the label. Pretty exotic lady playing a banjo or a ukulele. Yeah. There's also some blurb on the back, but in this light, in the small print, and the salt in my eyes from the sea air. I can't read it. Oh, I think we put my monocle on. Or get my telescope out, even, to try and read this. But I think it tells you the story of Norman Sailor Jerry Collins, father, as we've learned, of the old school tattoo. Now that's going to be one of them, you know, hammered into you. You know, that old, that bluey, that blue dye. You know, them old proper tattoos. Again, like in previous videos, what you can't see behind is the husky. The presence of Roxy the husky dog is moving about. And she may well start knocking things over. But that will give us the impression of being on a storm-tossed schooner out on the high seas. And in times of dramatic weather and high adversity, what's best to do? Batten down the hatches and drink some good stuff. Hide in a corner and cry until it's all over. This, of course, is the Hans Zimmer score. It's Pirates of the Caribbean. I know other people appeared as the composer named as somebody else. Klaus Badelt did this one for the first Pirates of the Caribbean movie. Only he didn't do it. It's Hans Zimmer through and through and through. Hans Zimmer had a company called Remote Control. If you all know who Hans Zimmer is, Hans Zimmer is the fucking go-to guy for any fucking movie that comes out. Who do you need? Think of a composer. Hans Zimmer? Anyone else got any suggestions? Hans Zimmer. Okay, a show of hands. A show of hands. All the Zimmers. So he gets the gig for pretty much everything that comes along. He's the first person they call. But he owned a company called Remote Control. And the reason why, well, it's a less than subtle reason. All his proteges, people he would enlist, people he'd recruit and train, and then send out to the film scoring world, every single one of their scores sounds exactly like a Hans Zimmer score, because he's taught them what he should do, as he did for, what was it now? I think it was Black Hawk Down, which has a great soundtrack, by the way. So don't go thinking that I'm just slating Hans Zimmer. I love a lot of his scores, but I hate what he's done to film music in general. It's the rum talking, God. But what he would do, like, for example, with Black Hawk Down, there's a track called Tribal War, and he went out and he got everybody, all of the most exotic percussionists, for the most weird and wonderful, you know, things that you just hit, just drums of all ethnic varieties. Got them all in the room together and they bashed hell out of it. And it's a really bit similar to what you just heard there. Dun, 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 dun. Because he's another self-plagiarist. A lot of his scores sound the fucking same as what he did previously. And it's a really belching bit of music, just purely tribal, adrenalized, you know, very primal. And but then after he recorded that, he went and fucking sampled it. He put it into a computer and he changed and modulated it all. What was the fucking point of going around the world and recruiting all these crazy virtuoso percussionists when you're gonna go and fucking sample it anyway? And that, folks, is what he does. He did it for The Dark Knight Rises, where he recorded people at the, somewhere in the UK, it was a football stadium, and he recorded people chanting, and it was the Bane chant, you know? And what did he do with that again? He took it back and he sampled it and modulated it and completely fucking changed it. So that out of the, I don't know, 10,000 people who were there, you know, actually it's a lot more than that. You wouldn't recognize your voice amongst that crowd. Nobody would, because he transformed the whole bloody thing anyway. But back to the name remote control. Remote control? So you're sitting there and you control things from a distance. That's pretty much how he operates when it comes to, you know, all his proteges he sends out into the big wide world, and Hollywood takes them on board, eh? But he doesn't cast them adrift, he controls them from a distance. No, I think you should do this. Oh, I'll rewrite that section for you. So in the end, even if their name is on the film as the composer, and some of these guys are good composers in their own right. I'll tell you another one, Ramin Djawadi, who did the score for Game of Thrones. Now, his early scores before Game of Thrones were shit, because they were just pure versions of just underscore that Hans Zimmer would do. So basically Hans Zimmer's just gone like, here, take that, use that, that'll be enough. Yeah. And there's many other names who've come along. But, so he's controlling from a distance, remote control. I do believe the company's changed name now, but to something like Brainwash or multiple Hans Zimmers, you know. Zimmer clones, something like that. But anyway, folks, that was a little diversion. Just in case you were all sitting there thinking like, is he just gonna talk about rum and he's just gonna sit there and drink rum in front of us wearing a silly hat? Is that all he's gonna do? Well, no. As it happens, no. And purely at random, you got given a little journey, a little excursion across the high seas of musical scoring for movies. And why it's such a travesty at the moment, with very few singular voices, very few visionary composers out there. Don't get me wrong, Hans Zimmer is very experimental. He will try new things. His score for Dunkirk, for example, was different. His score for Interstellar was different. But it's this big wall of sound, and it's not organic anymore. His stuff ceased, none of this is instruments. This is synth. It's all fucking synth, this. Does sound good though. I do like this score. Well, they're the later scores in the series, because the series was fucking ridiculous. Pirates of the Caribbean, the first movie, itself goes on for too long. You know, it goes on for like an extra half hour or more when it should have really finished. Doesn't matter, it's such a flamboyant, enjoyable film. Swashbuckling to the nth degree. Then you got like Dead Man's Chest, At World's End, and fucking whatever the bullshit was called. I don't even remember because they were shit. They just went on too long and were boring. Fucking boring. And that was reflected in the soundtracks, and Hans Zimmer's name's on them. He was the composer. And it's just tedium. And yet, people who don't appreciate film music revere Hans Zimmer because he's the only name they know. So like, that score by Hans Zimmer, oh God, I bought that, and I bought the deluxe version. The deluxe version, well, good luck to you. An extra fucking half hour of just droning shite. Listen to me, that's the rum talking. It's good stuff though. Given the choice, I'd rather go for a single malt, but you know, that's just me. Nice. It ain't nothing special, I've got to be honest, it's nothing special. I'm not going to rush out and, you know, buy any more of this stuff, necessarily. But if it was offered to me again, I'd go, quite nice that. Enjoy that, it's alright. So folks, I've waffled on for 15 minutes. 15 minutes of inane brevity and completely undisguised alcoholism. Some people have told me, my kids watch your videos. Excuse me? Your kids? How old are your kids? Are they 18, 20, you know? No, 6, 7, 8. What? What? You let them watch Kilt-Man? Kilt-Man, who notoriously Fs and blinds like there's no tomorrow. And I fucking do, you know. Sometimes I swear too much, but hey. As Stephen Fry would say, it's all part of the human language, you know? Sometimes other words will not do. But I do discuss certain themes and stuff. Well, this stuff, you know, I can't really be sitting there endorsing, you know, destroying your liver on an almost, you know, minute by minute basis. Although I do. The big screen is on. This is not the film that's playing, by the way. This is just the soundtrack playing there. But it's roaring out of, well, just the frontal array of speakers. There's speakers all around this room, by the way. So when you're watching like a Dolby Atmos, good boy, sound, you know, recording, it's just unbelievably good. Do we get the main theme again now? Can't remember. No, obviously not. But yeah, so there you go. It's a swashbuckling Sunday afternoon for me. Where's the rum? Oh, it's here. That is a good theme, you know. Look, the thing about Hans Zimmer is I hate what he's done to modern music. The way it's devolved into a mush, an electronic mush. And again, do not get me wrong, I love me synth scores. John Carpenter, the ruler of synth scores. But there is something about the way that Hans Zimmer gets all the prestige, he gets all the accolades, the Oscars, the honours, and it's just the Lion King, you know, is it a live action? Do you know what? I don't even know. Young Kilt daughter watched Lion King and loved it. I am through with Disney rehashing their older movies in live action or CGI or whatever, you know? You've told the story once and you did it well. Don't do it again. That's just me. And I'm clearly in the minority there. Because Disney fucking rules the world. What have they got? They've got Marvel, they've got Star Wars. Oh, and by the way, fuck Star Wars. I'm fed up with Star Wars. Jesus Christ. Just change the record, will you? Oh, man. Controversial there, Kilty. Anyway, folks, I'm about to go out and sport this in some local taverns. Do you know why? We're still doing Kilt Daughter's bedroom. Just ripped the carpet up, all the woodwork, all the walls done. It's the woodwork needs doing. Oh God. Oh God, save me, save me. Why? You see me sneaking off to do, just doing a video, hon. Just doing a YouTube video, you know, for the subscribers. Which reminds me, my fantastic, loyal, subscribing buddies out there, could you please tell your friends, your family members, not the younger ones. Oh, hey, they're welcome to, it don't matter. But just tell the world that Kilt-Man need you. This is the inspiring music. Kilt-Man needs you for the Tartan Crusade. We can. We definitely can, and we will make changes. These things don't have to be irreverent. They can be about something. The more people that subscribe, and the more, you know, feedback that I get, the more noble our aspirations could be, the more good we can do for the world. If not the world's liver will suffer. That, of that, I can guarantee you. But if I can make just one person smile, smirk, and buy a silly hat, then my job is doth done. So folks, with all this in mind, tell your friends, get them to hit that subscribe button, and make sure you hit that bell, that little bell thing, little bell icon thing. And when you hit that, it means that each time I unleash myself upon the world via the medium of YouTube, then you'll be notified. Little bell will ding, and like you'll go, oh God, no! Someone's like missed his medication again. Someone's left the cell door open. So, have I drunk all that? Shit. I winced. You see that? I actually winced then. I wonder why that is. I wonder why I didn't wince before, but I winced then. How does that happen? It's a little tricks. There's tricks in its little alcoholic sleeve, you know. Anyway, I'll have another swig of this, then I'm gonna sign off. So, glug glug. Glug glug is great if you're swigging from a bottle. Glug glug is not so bad, not so good when your ship has sunk and you're going underwater. That glug glug ain't a friend. Hey! I think I can rock this image. Folks, have a good time. It's the end of the weekend-ish, almost. One afternoon to go through, and then it's Monday. Who cares? Honestly, who cares? Every day, every minute, have fun. Smile on your face, be happy. Be happy. Drink the good stuff, which is whiskey. But this'll do. You ain't got whiskey. Rum's okay. So, keep it kilted, keep it Celtic. Grow your hair. Wear triangular hats. Listen to pounding synth scores, which pretend to be orchestras. That is good, though. And I'm going to see you all later. It's a rum deal. In it just.